they're convinced the German will find absolutely nothing.
Flinders Petrie was already there. He stopped, I think, at the end of the 19th century working in Tell el Amarna, and for him, he was through. He had the idea, it is done, and nobody has to... There's nothing to find anymore. But, I mean, as we know, this was not true.
Borchardt, he came to Amarna initially because he saw it as a major source of information on domestic architecture. But at the back of his mind was the fact that he had close connections with the Berlin Museum, and he rather wanted something spectacular to bring back to Berlin.
At the beginning of the 20th century, Egypt was the world's largest hunting ground for archaeologists. Prussia had lagged behind in the race for treasures. Kaiser William ordered Borchardt to return with a trophy, whatever the cost. Before excavations begin, the clever archaeologist seeks the advice of Cairo's leading antiquarians, many of whom do business with looters. He's told that part of Akhenaton's ancient city has yet to be excavated. Borchardt is also an architect, and before arriving, he'd drawn up floor plans for the southeast sector. Once inhabited by artisans, but untouched by both the British and the looters. He's interested in housing, so he starts by digging through the larger villas. These can be distinguished on the site by the small mounds. Later, he extends the dig to include all the houses. And by an extraordinary stroke of luck, he uncovers the offices and the house of the sculptor Thutmosis, one of the highlights of its excavations. Borchardt soon realizes he's come across a property that includes several sculptors' studios. Excited, the archaeologist decides to dig through every square inch of the gardens. And behind the silos, he identifies the house of the senior craftsman, Thutmosis, the personal sculptor of Akhenaton and Nefertiti. And it was here that Borchardt is said to have found the bust. Intrigued, we retrace the steps one century later of archaeologist Ludwig Borchardt and search out the house where the bust was discovered. Tell el Amarna is a five-hour drive south of Cairo, Akhenaton and Nefertiti's ghost town. Joining us is Luc Vatrin, an expert in ancient Egyptian works of art, who's employed by the courts to identify forged pieces. Egyptian archaeologist Amada is the inspector general of the dig at Tell el Amarna.
Well, here, as you can see, is Borchardt's report, excavation.
As you can see, this is the official report made after the excavation by Borchardt. There is not a lot of things which concern directly.
Luc Vatrin has an exceptional document, notes and sketches of archaeologist Ludwig Borchardt, in which he writes extensively of his discovery of the bust in 1912. The document will prove invaluable in tracing the exact spot where Nefertiti's bust was uncovered.
Look, Patrick, now we arrive to the house of Thutmosis. This is a very important house, which we find, which Borchardt in 6 December 1912 find the bust of Nefertiti, which now in Berlin Museum.
This is what remains 3,300 years later of the studio of Thutmosis, the chief sculptor. It's in one of these rooms that Borchardt, the German archaeologist, reportedly found the bust. With a map, archaeologist Luc Vatrin interprets the site.
Alors là, effectivement,
this is quite moving, because
vous
this
avez
is the villa's
la salle de réception du propriétaire
it's
de la villa. C'est très
that
certainement
this is where
ici
the owner
que ses hôtes de marque venaient,
his special guests,
mais également, pourquoi pas, venaient poser les hauts personnages de l'État et pourquoi
Queen
pas
Nefertiti
la reine
Nefertiti
elle-même. Alors on quitte la salle de la réception et là, bien évidemment, on arrive sur l'atelier du sculpteur.
And behind the door,
Borchardt est très précis dans ses écrits,
notes are very precise about this.
Dans
it's right here, in this corner, that he found the bust of the queen. So according to Borchardt, Nefertiti was here, buried for more than 3,200 years, yet still so realistic.
But that's not all, because the house of Akhenaton's senior sculptor turns out to be filled with treasures. Borchardt discovers other pieces, the finest collection of busts from the period, plaster masks, strangely lifelike, and models of studios like Akhenaton's. A model that's incomplete, and the famous bust of Akhenaton himself found lying next to Nefertiti's. Ludwig Borchardt donates all his finest trophies to the museum in Berlin. But in all this archaeological fairy tale, there's one detail that grabs the attention of a historian. It's an element that will spark an investigation worthy of a detective novel. In his colonial-style house in Cairo, Ludwig Borchardt will take more than 10 years before he publishes the complete report on his digs at Tell al-Amarna. He tells how he found the limestone bust of Nefertiti, and another bust also in limestone found alongside of the pharaoh Akhenaton, its face ripped apart. In his topographical notes, Borchardt takes great care to note the location of the bust of Nefertiti. He also marked where the disfigured bust of Akhenaton had been found. According to his drawings, the bust of Nefertiti was on a shelf in a corner of the studio. The bust of Akhenaton was the first to be found on the floor near the entrance to the left. But the passage of time caused the outer wall to crumble and the bust of Nefertiti with it. Akhenaton's bust was found in several pieces, while strangely, Nefertiti's was intact, almost as if it had just left the sculptor's studio. The whole story was pure deception, made up by Borchardt. That was the conclusion of Swiss historian Henri Stierlin, who had investigated the case for 20 years. He questions Borchardt's report and concludes that Nefertiti was, quote, simply too beautiful to be authentic. How is it possible that such a heavy object, such a delicate object, so finely painted, should have fallen, like Borchardt claims, from a shelf about a meter and a half from the floor onto stones and rubble, without being damaged, especially since he claims it fell face down? And then he says it's such a delicate object. I mean, it's hardly possible that only the ears were damaged. And besides, the ears wouldn't even have hit the floor when the object fell. When his inquiry began in 1984, Henri Sterlin expressed his doubts to Dietrich Wildung, one of the greatest German archaeologists, and beyond all reproach, at the time, the director of the museum in Munich. Wildung had studied the bust for many years and shares Stierlin's doubts. He had written a letter to Stierlin. Well, in the letter that he wrote, he said, my project was valid and persuasive. And here, let me quote you word for word. He writes, sehr schlüssig und überzeugend. In other words, convincing and coherent. In the letter, Dieter Wildung also admits to his own suspicions about the state of conservation of the Nefertiti bust, and that its style was not consistent with the Akhenaton period, and that he was even willing to write the introduction to his report. Then in 1989, he's named the curator of the bust of Nefertiti and makes a dramatic U-turn. And then Wildung suddenly sends me another letter in which he says he's been named the director of the Berlin Museum, where the Nefertiti bust is housed. And the whole issue has now taken on a different meaning, in that he was distancing himself from the inquiry and therefore could no longer get involved. But to me, the most worrying thing was when two representatives came down from Berlin to persuade me to stop my research.
deux émissaires qui sont chargés de me dissuader de continuer ma recherche.
Historian Eris Darlan is not someone who is easily intimidated and will continue his relentless investigation, albeit now totally isolated. Fascinated by the story, we head back to Berlin for a meeting with Dietrich Wildung. On the eve of our interview, the archaeological expert decides to cancel. We call back, pretending we haven't received his message.
Hello.
Hello, Wildung here.
Oui, Monsieur Dietrich.
Mr. Dietrich Wildung. Yes.
Je vous appelle parce que nous avons
I'm calling because we have a meeting arranged for tomorrow about
Nefertiti.
Au sujet de
Nefertiti. Je
voulais savoir à quelle heure on se retrouvait. J'ai envoyé
aujourd'hui.
I sent an email out today. In which I absolutely refuse to talk about that object. Otherwise, I might have serious difficulties. We'll later learn that the German authorities have formally forbidden Herr Wildung to talk about Nefertiti's bust or to mention Henri Sterland's research.